week, for those of you that weren't here, we jumped into John chapter 1, looked at the prologue of John, and then we talked a lot about John the Baptist and really his role as Elisha, that he was the prophet who was really making way for the coming Christ. And so tonight we are going to look at the image of Jesus, Jesus as a man. Who was Jesus? This is what we call Christology. So it's our understanding of who Jesus was as a human being.
So growing up as a kid, I was a pastor's kid. I was at church every time the doors were open. I pretty much lived at the church. I was there all the time. And my church, like most little churches growing up, I'll be honest, like it had some real creepy parts. Anybody have a creepy church growing up? There's like that corner that you didn't want to go into unless a buddy was with you. There's just some weird areas. Well, there was this one area in the far back of the church that I grew up in. And in this very back far corner of this one room, there was this one picture of Jesus. And so I want to show you what Jesus looked like to me as a kid. This was the picture that haunted my dreams as a child. Anybody seen that one before? That thing just like, it haunted it. To this day, I'm like, oh, whoa. Jesus is a little scary, right? Like, Jesus is a little scary. But that's the image of Jesus that I had growing up as a boy. Now, some of you might have an image of Jesus that looks something like this. We've got this like really Caucasian white guy that always has his finger in the air with a halo behind him, and he's always carrying a lamb. I'm not really sure how efficient or effective of a person you can be if you carry a lamb everywhere you go. I'm just throwing that out. I don't think that carrying a lamb around is going to be the most effective use of your arms. So this maybe is the image of Jesus that you have growing up, that he was this soft, kind of meek male that carried lambs around everywhere that he went. Well, what about the world? What does the world think about Jesus? I'm not talking about the physical person of Jesus, but I'm talking about who was Jesus. Maybe some people in the world believe that Jesus was a great teacher. He was maybe a prophet. Some people might see him as some sort of oppressor. Some people might see him as a savior. And then I think the church, we would universally agree as the church that Christ is the savior. He is God. He is God's son. He is God in flesh. So let's talk a little bit about what we know about Jesus, and then we're going to dive into the text and see what we can learn about Christ tonight. So we know that Jesus was approximately 30 years old when he started his ministry. So prior to starting his ministry, he spent his time working for his dad. His dad, Joseph, of course, was a carpenter, right? And so I explained to you guys back, I think it was in week two, that carpentry back then really meant masonry, it meant stonework. It was more than just working with wood. So Jesus would have been a guy that was working with wood all the time. He would have been working with stone, with rocks. And keep in mind, this is hard work, right? Carrying all this type of wood. There's no power tools. So it's safe to assume that Jesus was probably pretty physically fit. Also, remember, they walked pretty much everywhere that they went. So Jesus is probably a dude that's in pretty good shape. So this meek, pale Jesus, that's probably not what he looked like. In Matthew chapter 4, we're going to jump into Matthew for just a second. You can turn your Bibles there. We're going to start in verse 18. This is the calling of the disciples. And so what we see in verse 18, it says this: as Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon and Peter, and he called out to them. They were casting their nets on the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come and follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once, they left their nets and they followed him. Going from there were two other brothers, James and John, the son of Zebedee. And they were on a boat, their father's boat, preparing their nets. And Jesus called to them. And immediately, they left their boats and they left their father and they followed him. So let's just make this modern day real quick. Who's seen the show Deadliest Catch? Right, Deadliest Catch, these guys are commercial fishermen. These are rough dudes. If you've watched the show, I think half of the show is just one giant bleep, right? Because they're just always using profanity. These are rough dudes. So think about this meek version of Jesus that a lot of us have in our mind. You've got a guy with his finger in the air carrying the lamb, right? And he sees these commercial fishermen, rough dudes, and he's like, "Hey, come follow me." And they're like, "Cool, I'm in. I'm going to follow the guy with the lamb." Probably not the picture of Jesus that would have been able to convince some guys who are commercial fishermen to drop what they were doing and to follow him. So Jesus was a guy that when these men's men saw him, they wanted what he had. There was something about him that had a lot of charisma, that had a lot of draw, that made them say, you know what, I'm going to stop what I'm doing. I'm going to give up my career. I'm going to give up my livelihood, and I'm going to follow this guy because I want to see what he has to say. Jesus is someone that absolutely drew people. How many of you guys in here are married? Show of hands. All right. How many of you guys in here want to be married at some point? Extra points for your wife there because you yelled out. She's not here, by the way. yep. A few hands in the back. Want to be married one day. Think back to your wedding for just a second. Okay. Think back to your wedding. Who are the people that you invited to your wedding? They're people that you wanted to be around. They're people that you trusted, people that you loved, people that you didn't feel condemned by, people that supported you. These are the people that we bring to our weddings. They're people that we trust, that we love, that we want to be around. And so it's interesting that Jesus' first miracle happens at a wedding. Now, think back to a couple weeks ago, we set up the Gospels. We talked about first century Palestine and what was happening. And we talked about the social environments of weddings. Weddings, of course, are the biggest celebration of a Jewish person's life at the time. These things would go on for 5 to 7 days. These were big, giant parties. These weddings would really help your social setting go up or go down depending on how they go. So let's take a look and see what happens in this account in John chapter 2. Got your Bibles? Go ahead and open them up. We're going to be in John chapter 2, starting in verse 1. On the third day, a wedding took place in Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. So again, keep in mind that weddings are huge celebrations of people that we love, and so Jesus and his disciples were the type of people that other people wanted to be around. So Jesus and his disciples are here. They're hanging out at this wedding. Jesus is a guy that has character. He has charisma. He has direction. And he's fully God, but he's also fully man. And that's an easy thing for me to say. He's fully God. He's fully man. But it's a very confusing thing for us to process and understand. And I love what Dr. Tony Evans says about this. I think this is one of the greatest quotes. He says this: Jesus could be thirsty because he was fully human. He could walk on water because he was fully God. John 2 shows us this first miracle that happens at this wedding. And it's interesting to see that this miracle was a miracle of provision. It wasn't raising someone from the dead or some miraculous healing or Jesus doing something incredible with nature. It was really a miracle of provision and protecting the social setting and the social class of these people that he came to celebrate with. So let's look and see what happens. I know that most of you have heard this story. You're like, yeah, Jesus turned water to wine. Got it. Let's move on. Well, let's dig in and let's see if we can learn something a little bit more about this miracle as we take a little bit of time to process it. So let's jump into verse 3 of John chapter 2. When the wine had gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind that the Jews use for ceremonial washing, each holding between 20 and 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. So let's get a little bit of understanding of what's happening here, and let's do a little bit of math so that we can kind of get an idea of the volume of wine that Jesus produced. So the jars that were set aside were between 20 and 30 gallons. So let's average those and let's call them 25 gallons each. There was approximately 6 of them that were there. So we have 25 gallons right in each one. There's 6 of them. So that's 150 gallons. There are 4 quarts to a gallon. Are y'all still with me? So there's 4 quarts to a gallon. So if we took those 150 gallons, Jesus would have approximately produced somewhere between 600 and 720 bottles of wine during this miracle. Now, I've read this story a ton of times, and until I took the time to go through and do the math and to calculate, it gets a little bit cooler because for me, for whatever reason, I thought Jesus turned water to wine. It was like he was some sort of magician. There was one glass of wine. He put a little cover. It's like, washa, wine. That's not what happened here. Jesus made 600 to 720 bottles of wine. So not only does Jesus meet the need that is there, he exceeds the need. In verse 8, it says, "Then he told them, 'Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet.'" So let's just take a time out here. Who is the master of the banquet? The master of the banquet, in simple terms, this guy's like a professional partier, right? This is what he does. He hosts wedding celebrations. And so they bring this wine to this guy who has definitely drank his fair share of wine. He knows what good wine is. Let's see his response in verse 9. And so they did. And the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn out the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and he said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best until now." So not only does Jesus meet and exceed this need, Jesus meets and exceeds it, and he brings the absolute best when he meets this need. Verse 11, "What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of many signs which revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him." So what's the significance of this miracle? Well, Jesus' mission was always about the people. It was always about caring for the people. In 1 Peter 5:7, it says, "Cast your cares on him because he cares for you." So this is a personalized verse. This is saying whatever concern you have, whatever care you have, you can cast it onto him because he cares for you. There's no scope, there's no size requirement for what a care is. If it's a burden to you, he cares. And so in this setting, Jesus cared that there was not enough wine to go around. He was saving these people from a social embarrassment. He was providing for them so that socially they would be seen as people who put on a great wedding. So for us, whether it's sickness, whether it's your marriage, your job, your finances, you can cast your cares on him because he cares for you. There's a huge lesson that's here that we can learn if we look back at Mary and how Mary interacted with Jesus. Let's go back to verse 3, and maybe you want to grab a pen and a highlighter and take some notes in your Bible in the margins. It says in verse 3, "When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, 'They have no more wine.' 'Woman, why do you involve me?' Jesus replied, 'My hour has not yet come.' His mother said to the servants, 'Do whatever he tells you.'" And then if you read the account as it continues, there is not another mention of Mary. And so Mary brings her need to Jesus. She knows that Jesus can meet the need, and then she's out. She lays her need at the foot of the one who can meet and the one who can provide, and she says, "He's got it. I'm out." Jesus even responds to her and says, "Why do you involve me?" And she's like, "I know you can meet the need." Then she turns to the servant and says, "Do what he says to do, because I know that he can meet my need." What a lesson that is for me. Man, there are so many times that I have a need. I have something that I need from God, and I bring it to him, and I say, "Hey, God, here's my need. Now let me tell you how to meet my need. This would be the best. Let's go from A, B, and then we'll hit step C, and then eventually we'll get to Z. That would be perfect if we could work it out that way." Anybody else guilty of that? And so what a lesson it is for us that we would bring our need the way that Mary brought her need, and that we would trust that Jesus would meet it and take care of it. There's a theme here between the calling of the disciples and Mary's response to the lack of wine. It's this word trust. See, what we see from the disciples is that they left everything to follow Jesus. Thinking back to this social settings talk that we did a few weeks ago, a boy would have followed in his father's footsteps. So these men, these disciples who were fishers, they had learned this trade most likely as children. This was their livelihood. These boats were most likely their dad's. They had earned their living day after day by catching these fish. And what they did when they followed Jesus was they laid aside their ability to provide for themselves. And they said, "I trust in what this guy has for me more than I trusted my own ability to provide for myself." The theme of tonight is trust. And so the question is this for us: do you trust him with your concerns? Do you trust him with your marriage? Do you trust him with your finances? Do you trust him with that next thing? Do you trust him with that sickness? Do you trust him with the calling that he's put on your life? Do you trust him to provide your next breath? I love what Craig Rochelle says. He says, "What we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least." What we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least. So where is that place in your life that you have fear? Because that, my friend, is the place where you are lacking in trust. And so the challenge tonight is that we would step into trusting Jesus the way that Mary did and the way that the disciples did, that we would set whatever it is that we have, whatever need, whatever fear, whatever concern, and that we would set it at his feet, knowing that he can provide more than we could ever ask or imagine, more abundantly, more extravagantly than we could ever ask or imagine. It might not look the way that we had it planned out, but I promise the way that he has it planned is what is best. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you are a God who provides extravagantly above and beyond. God, that you meet every single one of our needs. God, and you give us an opportunity to trust you with our life, to trust you with the calling that you've given us, to trust you with our marriages, to trust you with our finances. And so, God, I pray tonight that we would inspect our hearts. God, that you would search us, as the psalmist says, and that you would show us the area where we are lacking in trust and that we are filled with fear. God, we know that fear is not from you, and I pray that we would be able to step into trust and that we would give these areas over to you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, homework for this week. We're going to go to John chapter 3. Yes, I'm in John 3. Next week, we're going to go through, we're going to read that, read it in two different versions of the Bible. Ask yourself the question, what does this say about God? What does this say about man? And then what is my application or takeaway? How am I going to walk differently because of interacting with this text? If tonight's your first night, you need a small group, come up and see me. We'll get you put into a group. Otherwise, you guys are dismissed. Stay well. See you guys next week.